Ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to this Scotch Watch Christmas special. I'm taking the pose of Ricky Fulton here, if anyone remembers him, the Reverend I Am Jolly. Now, this is our 8th episode. We're delighted to be seeing out the year and delighted to see you all on. Yep, no one knew it was formal dress, Caroline, until we dialed in and saw Santa in his finest dress. So, welcome to Scotch Watch Christmas special. Tonight we're going to uncover whisky, one dram and one story at a time in your company this festive season. Now, I'm Alex Robertson, Head of Heritage and Education at Shivers Brothers. And of course, as always, I'm delighted to be joined by my sartorially elegant co-host, Sandy Hyslop, Director of Blending. Sandy, looking sharp. How are you tonight? Our last Scotch Watch of the year.
Alex, I'm flipping fantastic. I thought I'd make a bit of an effort tonight, seeing it was our Christmas episode. And to be honest, this is about as near as me and you are going to get to a Christmas night out, Robbo. Honestly, this is it. This is our Christmas night out. What a night. We're finishing on a real crescendo tonight. We've got Royal Salute. We've got a very, very special guest. This is going to be an absolute belter.
Here's hoping. Looking great. Is it a tartan bow tie, Sandy, is it?
It's actually Keepers of the Quake.
Ooh, oh, wow. Keepers of the Quake, is it? Excellent. So tonight we welcome three guest stars, ladies and gentlemen, three guest stars in total. First of all, recently named a rising star by Walpole in their power list and one of the 50 most influential people in British luxury, our next guest is part of the Royal Salute marketing team. On the award, she said, "It is a privilege to be able to wave the flag on behalf of many young, diverse women in the whisky industry." Absolute delight. And coming to us live from Brazil, welcome to Scotch Watch, Amabile Guglielmino-Brady.
Oh, wow.
Not bad, eh?
Not bad.
Hey, Amma, welcome along. It's so good to have you. And listen, congratulations on the award.
Thank you. Thank you. It's such a pleasure to be here. You guys are two legends. I'm so delighted to be with both of you, with my beloved Royal Salute, and to be with everyone joining us here. So I can't wait for us to taste the delicious things.
Oh, honestly, I've had the snow pole all day. Well, listen, tell us more about this award, Amma. Absolutely astonishing.
Oh, wow. That was a surprise. I'm sure my mom is very proud of that. That was a surprise to me. Of course, Royal Salute has a fantastic partnership with Walpole for a long time. And I've been as part of what I do, which I'll be telling everyone very soon. I manage the relationship with them and has been a fantastic past 3 years in between Royal Salute and them. And then they came as a surprise. So I'm very honored because from São Paulo, Brazil, all the way to be influential in UK. So that's like, wow, Mama has the frame on the wall, you know. So it's an incredible honor. Also on the behalf of my colleagues in Royal Salute and all the ladies in the industry. So it's not something for me, it's for everyone.
Ah, superb. And I think everyone will congratulate you. It's a great achievement. But it was Walpole. Does appearing in Scotch Watch maybe top that, Amma?
That's a different level, guys. I cannot even compare, you know.
It's the
two
right
legends,
hand.
Yeah. It's like the ultimate, you know, the pinnacle of the year to me is being here, of course.
Ah, brilliant. Brilliant. Well, listen, we're going to hear a lot more from you shortly, Amma, especially in that role with Royal Salute, and also you're going to take us through a tasting of some rather fine whiskies. Our next guest star is an absolute cracker. It was first launched in 1953. It's the only whisky in the world, starting at 21 years old, and it is the Royal Salute Signature Blend. So we're going to be tasting that very, very soon. And joining Royal Salute Signature Blend is this absolute beauty. Look at this. Isn't that stunning? Royal Salute Snow Polo. And we're going to be enjoying that very soon too. Beautiful whiskey at 46.5% alcohol. And we're going to find out exactly why. Thank you, David. The best dressed Zoom panel ever. Superb. So we're going to get into this very, very soon and have a look at that. Now, you can expect some rather banal banter for the next 30 minutes or so. First of all, I want to thank all of you for supporting Scotch Watch in 2020. We broadcast about 30 countries. We do hope you feel that it's brought people together at a very difficult time and given you an informal look behind the scenes at Scotch Whisky and actually our passions and an opportunity to meet the people behind Scotch. Now, this is episode 8. We're broadcast now to more than 1,000 people. So anyway, thank you. And I hope you've seen another side of Scotch. Now, please feel free to ask your questions of Sandy and Amma throughout. All you have to do is raise your hand if you want. I can activate your microphone and camera so you can ask yourself a very special edition of Scotch Watch. So just raise your hand, put a question in the Q&A field, stick something in the chat, and we'll get you on screen as soon as possible. Now, before turning to our whiskies, we're going to move to our regular hobby session. And I believe Sandy's going to absolutely knock it out of the park tonight. So, Sandy, we know you're a collector. You're standing in front of your dinky toys again and a rather fine Royal Salute setup. What are you wearing tonight?
Oh, God, I've been really excited about tonight. Honestly, in watch collecting circles, this tonight is a hashtag NWA. Okay? New watch alert. I've had this watch for about a fortnight, and anybody who knows me well knows that I am rubbish at keeping things under wraps. I'm rubbish, and it's taken me all my time not to post this watch on Instagram or give it a bit of an airing. So I've kept it tonight for the grand release, and that's exactly what it is. Tonight, we have got a Grand Seiko Spring Drive GMT 20th Anniversary Chronograph. We're talking 500 pieces worldwide, titanium, hand-built. Thinking about Royal Salute, thinking about how it's crafted, how it's bespoke. This is the pinnacle of watchmaking. This is more accurate than anything from Switzerland. This is absolutely watchmaking at its best. Grand Seiko is a complete company on its own. This watch is built in-house. Every single piece of the watch is made, brought together into the final watch in-house in Seiko. Nothing bought in. They make absolutely everything. Now, it's got a stop. In fact, I might even do a bit of a wrist roll here.
Nice watch roll. I spotted it.
Yeah, you see that nice wrist roll?
Ooh,
nice.
Now, that's gorgeous.
It's a beauty.
It has a wonderful dial. The dial is, it's very difficult to see it. I'm going to post a picture on Instagram later. It's hand die cut, and it's there to represent a lion's mane. So I thought that fits in absolutely perfectly with Royal Salute. I'm ticking so many boxes tonight. It's unbelievable. But 500 pieces worldwide. This is super, absolutely delighted to have managed to acquire one. So there you go, Alex. Man, what are you saying about that?
Well, all I'm saying about that is question in everyone's mind, how much? Let's be honest.
Tell us the dollars.
It was reassuringly expensive.
Oh, good. So what we'll do is tomorrow we'll get that clip on Instagram. We'll try and get a tie-up with Grand Seiko. We'll see how it goes. And Royal Salute.
Yeah, okay. Come on then. What are you saying about music?
Right.
Let's see what you've done. I hope you've knocked it out the park as well. I hope you've put a lot of thought into this, Robbo.
Do you know what I have? And I started to think, links with royalty, and all I could come up with was the purple past Prince of Pop, Prince himself, Purple Rain. Absolutely incredible album, love it, but I thought that was a bit just too obvious, far too obvious. So anyway, fantastic album, love it, play it endlessly. Sorry, my deedly boppers are slipping. So what I thought I would do is tonight, I thought I would announce Scotch Watch's inaugural album of the year. What do you think of that? So last night, if anyone sees me on Instagram, Dram Good Life, you'll see last night I posted my 5 albums that I think should be in the album of the year. We had Mark Lanigan in there. We had Jarvis Cocker, if anyone remembers him. Anyone remember Jarvis Cocker from his pulp days? Yeah. We had a bit of Laura Marling. We had Mark Lanigan, and we had Baxter Dury. So all 5 of them in my albums of the year, and I settled on, drum roll, we will maybe in the new year get some investment behind this. And we absolutely settled on Jarvis. Absolutely amazing album. Solo album from Jarvis after his Pulp days. Incredible album. My album of the year. Because of one track, which is called House Music All Night Long. And it just takes me right back to the 1980s. Look at that. Our 1990s gatefold sleeve. So Scotch Watch's album of the year, Beyond the Pale by Jarvis. Now, if anyone can put their albums of the year or their favourite Christmas songs in, please just do. Megan, Ariana Grande's just sitting behind me. That's the... is there. I'm absolutely...
I'm with you. Ariana Grande, Dua Lipa, you know, bring it on.
I've got my Box Fizz album here as well.
Lonnie Donegan's there as well, Tristan. They are there. You know, try to play it cool with these obscure choices. And the truth is Ariana Grande and Lonnie Donegan. Anyway, Amma, I'm sure you can see that Sandy and I are stretching out this hobby bit a bit. But anyway, what's your hobby, Amma? We always ask our guests every week, what's your passion?
Drink, joking. please, responsible drinking, everyone. Traveling. I think that what I can say is I love traveling. I think from Brazil to the world, you know, like coming from down south and then be able to discover the entire world, especially working Rio Salute. I think that was the beauty of it. And to me, every single time I can travel, I'm traveling. If it's not working, it's holidays, I'm there. I love to discover different cultures, diversity, people. That's enchanting, as people love to say.
Any favourite places? I second that, absolutely. That's what actually led me to whisky. An obvious passion for whisky, but the ability to travel globally.
Yes, so there is a place that lives in my heart called India. India is very special. I think everything about India, it brings me sort of back to where I'm from. We have a lot of similarities. And all those colours and the people and the food, and it's just... unique. Every single time I arrive in India, it's just like, oh, please, I want to stay longer. It's so incredible. So if we have any Indian friends here, guys, love India. Can't wait to be back.
Yeah.
So absolutely. in your job, Amma, what does a week consist of normally? I know you do a bit of traveling, and I'll come to that in a minute. But when you're not jetting around the world representing Royal Salute, what do you do in London? You know, what do you do as your normal day job?
So my normal day in our office in Chiswick. What do I do? So let me just tell everyone what do I do in Royal Salute. So I'm a global senior brand manager for the brand, and I am responsible for driving value within the brand. This is very marketing words, apologies. And it's basically creating all these amazing experiences with the brand to really, really introduce the brand to potential customers, consumers, or to enhance relationship with our already customers and consumers. So all these beautiful events and collaborations that we do, as I mentioned, Walpo in this case, but we do with the Polo, which I know we're going to talk about this in a minute. Can't wait. And now, of course, with this horrible coronavirus, which fingers crossed we are pretty much in the end of the storm, I hope so. We're trying to migrate from what we're doing physically to virtually. Of course, we'll never be the same. I can't wait to be back on the road again. There's a jet setter. And of course, get to meet people face to face and travel with you, Mr. Hyslop. I miss our, you know, our traveling all over the world, our taxi chats. Don't tell anyone.
that's a new that. Year edition of Scotch Watch.
We'll end up with parental guidance on the podcast.
See you think, Sandy, 2021 taxi chat instead of Scottish one.
Honestly,
yeah, I sat in the back of a taxi.
We should have a new theme here, taxi chat. Will be the next one.
Yeah. So tell me, we've been really lucky, Amma. We've been to some amazing venues for Royal Salute for the launches. We've been to San Moritz. We've been to Aspen. We've been all over the place. You know, tell me. I know you've said you love India, but tell me. Where's the place that's really been interesting for you? You know, these special editions are just fantastic, and they're all very, very different. And so are the venues. China, all these places are just unbelievable.
Wow, it's as you said, the Polo collection is just incredible in every single way. And I think this affinity that Royal Salute has with the sport Polo, that's the sport of the Kings, which is clear, the connection. I think I don't even need to explain this. So being able to activate, we call platform, so be able to activate the liquid, the whiskey with this beautiful Polo platform and then run these events all over the world is just incredible. I think one of my favorite, most interesting places, which it really leads me to think about the launch of the very special snow polo, is Samohit, which I think is just like a wow. Like watching those horses playing polo in the snow in the top of the Alps, Swiss Alps, is just like unforgettable. I think it's an experience life that I wish and I hope everyone in the world could see it. It's absolutely incredible.
Yeah, we love, in the blending room, myself and the blending team, we just love making these Royal Salute Polo editions because they're a chance to experiment and try different cask finishes and different flavours and, you know, just to give everybody a bit of background. Every single one is different, isn't it, Amma? Every one that we've done for all the different countries and all the different types of polo, we've done different flavour, haven't we?
Yes, it's just incredible you're saying this because, again, we always try to put together those flavors that remind those particular places in the polo at the same time, which I think is just so beautiful. And how if you have a dram, straight away, if you close your eyes, you can remember those places. And I think that is the special thing about the polo collection, is how you can have a sip and you can picture yourself in summer eats, you know, in the snow, in the season. That's just so incredible. And also the beach polo one, which was the previous one, how you close your eyes and you can imagine yourself in around a bonfire at the beach. It's just so, so, so incredible. And I really hope that when people are tasting this whiskey, they really get the same sense of these personal experiences and kind of transport them to somewhere else.
Yeah, I think it's amazing. It's great. I think for me, Amma, I think Royal Salute is in a real golden period at the moment. I think the signature blend, and as Alec touched on at the start, since 1953, the only whiskey in the world that's been available not less than 21 years old. It's just it's amazing. And the lost blend with the aged old silent distilleries and the malts blend, absolutely. And I know I'm biased, but this is a golden period for Royal Salute. It's really finding its feet.
It is. And I'm very proud to work in a brand that is just like literally growing and has so much story as well. And it's so authentic at the same time. And I think all this, the story, how it started in 1953 for the coronation of the queen. And come on, I'm the type of empowering ladies, diversity, everyone probably got it. So to me, it means a lot to be able to work on a branch that really, really gets me inside. And that turns into a huge passion, of course. So and it's the golden area. And we begin where the others end. So what else?
Don't you think it's absolutely amazing that we have the history of bottles actually being presented to the Queen at our coronation? We have the documentary evidence that the first batch, two bottles were given.
We actually did. It's just insane just to think about it. It's just like, oh my God, imagine. I'm sure most of the people here tonight has watched The Crown. So imagine, sometimes when I'm watching Netflix, I always picture like, oh my God, imagine when they gave Royal Salute, like, is this really, it's just incredible to think and kind of picture and visualize in your head the whole story of the brand with the monarchy. It's just fantastic.
Guys, I'm going to go with the questions for a wee minute because they're flooding in. And just go through the chat. I'm going to come back to you in a moment in that luxury world that we spoke about. Gerardo said he's feeling a bit underdressed. Kevin's joined us as well, as did Kelly. No idea it was formal dress, just a little different from last Christmas, says Emma. Absolutely, I agree. Jim, good to have you online too. Sandy, Gerardo says we need a new courier. His complimentary bottles keep getting lost. I like that.
Super. A shame. That's a real shame.
Stunning watch. Swapped it for a 62 gun salute. Love it. Bill, yes, we are recording. I did remember tonight, so this is being recorded.
Good, Bill. Alan, very good, Bill.
Alan, our ambassador in India, says, love to hear you love India. Christian says, you look very handsome, Sandy, as much as your guest. And Michael, great to have you on. Michael McLaren asks, Sandy, what inspires your favourite flavour selections from the different editions of Royal Salute?
To be honest, it's been quite inspirational, the Polo expression. You know, Amma and I have worked together, and the different ways that Polo is played. Polo's played on ice, Polo's played on sand at the beach, Polo's played on grass, and these were all real inspirations for the different expressions. You know, that grass, I wanted something really with a real floral bouquet in it. The beach, Amma's touched on it. I wanted a bit of smoke, but I didn't want it to be overtly smoky. I still wanted it to have that really rich, fruity Royal Salute style, but with just the sensation of smoke in there. It just makes such a difference. And we're going to come to the Snow Polo edition, which was, I think, really brave. We went right off piste with that, if you pardon the pun, and we tried to get something that was completely bold, different, and we're going to come to it very shortly, so I'm going to just hold fire just now, but they're great projects to work on.
Great question, on the piste, I like that. And we had a question in the chat from Kevin, who has our own royal in the blending room, Kevin Bamford, a.k.a. Prince Harry. And the question from Prince Harry is, have you met any royals, Amma?
It's Harry, that's the one. it's true, actually. I met him and Meghan literally straight after their wedding. And there was the Amabile Polo Cup, which Royal Salute sponsors. We are one of the partners of them for the past 10 years. So we're celebrating 10 years this year. And it was straight after the marriage. And of course, I met with a certain kind of distance, like a kind of 5 meters, but that was pretty incredible. I was like, oh my God, like it's real. Like they are in the house, you know, it was pretty insane.
As Michael says, though, I think Harry's out now, isn't he? So you need.
Yeah, but we've got our own Prince Harry in the blending room, who's far, far, far more royal.
I love it. Amma, tell me about. I'm fascinated about. You know, you're talking about snow polo. You're talking about San Moritz. You're talking about, you know, this luxury world. We mentioned wall polo. It might feel alien to a lot of people, but tell us about that world that Royal Salute occupies. And is it still as relevant today following the year we've had? And also, Royal Salute is still accessible to all, of course.
That's a very good question, actually. I think everyone probably thinking, oh, it was a very tough year and not consuming luxury goods and you know, it's a different mindset. But actually, if you can think that people like to treat themselves. I love having a treat. I think Royal Salute's a treat. You know, I think it's something that you need to drink and really appreciate, you know, and you can treat yourself. And of course, treat the people you love around you, your friends and colleagues. So I think for Royal Salute, despite, of course, I guess everyone, every brand has been impacted, but for us, it's the luxury still being consumed. And you can see that as a treating moment to yourself, particularly in 2020. I just seeing Mauricio and with some people here saying it's affordable. It's definitely affordable. Royal Salute, especially the signature, the molds, and the lost. And look, we are the pinnacle of the luxury Scotch whiskey, and this is how we want to be seeing. And again, we want to be more inclusive. You know, we don't want to lose who we are in terms of from where we started. So the coronation, all those beautiful storytellings, but also involve to the new generation of luxury consumers and make sure that we are inclusive. So we kind of welcome everyone into our kingdom. Welcome everyone. We want to reveal our kingdom. We want to invite people to come and enjoy this kingdom of Royal Salute. And as a luxury brand, it goes way beyond the liquid per se or the whiskey. There is a whole lifestyle that comes and all these experiences and moments and places. There is a whole lifestyle that accompanies the brand, which I think is pretty magic and definitely reveals the kingdom in a very unique way.
And do you think that's expanding globally? You think that Royal Salute, Sandy, I know you've been doing a lot of work on Royal Salute in recent years, traveling a lot. Are we seeing Royal Salute become more widely available globally, more well known globally?
It is. I think, of course, the Asian region is still pretty strong for a brand, but we are literally trying to conquer and expand in all the territories, such as US. There is a huge appetite for a salute there. I'm sure Carrie's still there, and she's a big lover, and we love her too. But there is a lot of appetite there. I think also here in Brazil, I was really surprised how it's growing in Latam and Brazil and São Paulo. Brazil and São Paulo is the biggest city, I would say, how there is a real passion for the brand and, you know, whiskey aficionados and how they really, really take it seriously. And also new adapters, you know, new consumers, like, let me try that thing that my dad used to drink because it's so good. And I love seeing this passing through generations. And this is my case. You know, my dad, I will never forget in my graduation in Brazil, my dad opening a bottle of Royal Salute. That was a big celebratory moment. You know, and I think this is beautiful how this passes into generations as a brand. And now as the new consumer is coming, those traditions are still very alive, but with their very own twist of contemporary.
I love it. And Sandy, what are people telling you when they're tasting it? You've been at these events, you're tasting some amazing whiskies out there. Tell us.
I love it. You know, Amma and I have been lucky enough to meet people more than once, you know, and when the Tri-Royal Salute, it's so full-flavoured. It's wonderful. 21 years, more than two decades maturing in a cask, and it has some amazing rich flavours, and we're going to come on and taste it very, very, very soon. But it almost brings people to a place in time. It's so flavourful that when they try it, and they'll buy it as a special gift or try it themselves at another time, it takes them right back to that time when they tried it the first time. It's so unique and huge depth of character that it lasts with people forever in the sort of flavour book inside their head. It's just amazing.
Do you know what? That's a lovely link, and it looks like eight episodes in, we're just getting it. Sandy, I think Carrie said it's an affordable luxury, you know, and Mauricio was saying, after this year, I deserve a Royal Salute, a perfect treat for Christmas. Gordon saying he's yet to try it. Dom, great to have you too. Yes, please.
I'll sort that out, Gordon.
David's dying of thirst, he says. You can buy it. I mean, what, £90 on Amazon at the moment, isn't it?
£90 at Amazon at the moment. It's not a very cheap whiskey, but my God, bang for your buck on flavour. It's just right up there. It is a beautiful whiskey that we take a lot of time and effort. Every individual cask we're nosing before it's emptied, before we blend it together, the effort, it really is. Each batch of Royal Salute is a bespoke offering, and we put a lot of effort into keeping that continuity of flavour year after year to make sure that we deliver that flavour that is expected from our loyal consumers.
Well, let's put David Forbes out of his misery because he's dying of thirst. Please let us know what you're all drinking. I saw a Glenburgie up there earlier as well.
Oh, nice.
Someone's enjoying a Glenburgie. Well, let's dive in. Let's go with the Royal Salute 21 Signature. Let's take that first. And Amma, what do you enjoy about this? What do you get in the Signature? Absolutely stunning.
I have to say it's my favorite. Oh, sorry, Sandy. Sorry, I hope I'm not making you sad or disappointed. But it's my favorite. I think it is what it is. It's where it started. I think it has an amazing, to me especially, I got a lot of marmalade. I'm not an expert, Sandy. Sorry about that, you. Nuts. That reminds a lot of the festive moment we are starting now with Christmas and all the celebrations. So I think it's the perfect, and it's the absolute the perfect whiskey for the moment, for celebrations of the festive season.
Oh, cheers, everyone! Greetings, season.
Cheers.
So full. Oh,
beautiful. It's got loads of that sweet pears and syrup on it. It just coats the mouth. It's absolutely wonderful. Wee bit of licorice, little bit of cinnamon in there. Just as you draw air in at the end, you're getting a little bit of that peaty, oily smoke coming in there. It's just wonderful. And the flavour stays on the palate for absolutely ages. You're not rushing back for another drink. It just gently subsides on the palate.
So
what do you think of it, Alex?
So smooth. You know, and yes. I agree with that, marmalade note, I love that, and then that nuttiness lovely. Underneath the richness, and then the creaminess, full flavour and smooth in the palate, absolutely adore it.
It's like marmalade, just with a wee touch of ginger in it. It's just got that gentle spice in there, just to lift it that little bit as well. Love it.
It's delicious. It's just like, and you feel like in your tongue, like a velvet finish to me at least. Mm. It's just incredible.
I think as Dory says, King of Whiskey, David, agree with that. My signature blend, sensational.
Cheers to Dory and David. Yeah. I agree with them too.
We've got Andrew Ginger Whiskey. Can't beat a touch of ginger. Andy's, he's actually in an emergency. He's run out of snow polo. Have you ever heard such a thing?
Outrageous. Outrageous.
Cheers. Outrageous. Not acceptable. That's not acceptable.
Sandy, I've got a good question for you from Gregor. But first, I want to know, we featured all our blended Scotches and Scotch Watch, Chivas, Ballantines. What's the challenge though when it comes to blending a whiskey starting at 21 years old? Is it a greater challenge in that process?
Yeah, what a flipping good question. When you're blending whiskies at 21 years old, you still want that fruity distillate character to come through. You want people to get that complexity, that they're getting more than one flavour, they're getting a few flavours when they taste the whiskey. And it's difficult at 21 years old. It's been in that cask for 21 years, and we need to manage the influence of the oak. And that's where myself and my team are working really hard with the cask selection to make sure you're still getting distillate character, but complemented with the vanilla, slightly nuttiness, some of the toasted notes are coming from the oak, but we've got to get it in balance. And that's where we spend a lot of time, cask selection, laying down the right stock 21 years ago, making sure, you know, there's three, myself, Kevin and Willie, together, we've got 100 years experience in working in the whiskey industry. It's flipping unbelievable. And we love it. We love being responsible for such a prestigious whiskey. But that's the hardest thing, Alex. The last thing I want is someone drinking Royal Salute and just getting loads of oak from the cask. I want them to get the distillate flavour there as well. I want complexity and balance.
Great. And the cask types, are we talking American or a mix, Hoggies?
Yeah, we're using, in the Royal Salute Signature Blend, we're using barrels, hogsheads and sherry butts in it as well. So not only is it a complex blend with lots and lots of different malt and grain whiskies in it, we're using a range of casks too. It has absolute fabulous depth and complexity in the blend. All these casks bring in different flavour. Your barrels are bringing sweet vanilla flavours. Your hogsheads are bringing some of that nutty notes. Your sherry casks are bringing raisin, a little bit of licorice in there as well. Each one's delivering their own flavour over and above the signature malts. That's Strathyla, Longmorn. There's some absolute classics in this blend that all come together to make this amazing flavour package.
Oh, I love a licorice reference. Must be using all sorts. So, Gregor, I see you have a question. Would you like to ask Sandy at direct, perhaps?
Oh.
If you can get your mic working, great to have you again. Feel free to ask a question, Gregor, or I can ask on your behalf.
Oh, it's gone all shy on me.
Ah, he's gone. I'll ask him to unmute. There you go.
Bit of stage fright.
There you go.
There we go.
That's better. Gregor, how are you?
Hello, people. Sandy, question.
Yes?
When you're blending whiskies, you're working with small samples.
Indeed.
Yeah, how did it work? Because the whiskies that are going to the bottles is obviously bigger batches. How does it work with the proportion? What we do
when we're blending something like the Royal Salute Snow Polo that we're going away to come on to shortly, we bring samples in from all the warehouses into the blending room. And then what we do is we make the blend in absolute miniature as it would be when the whole blend is put together. So we take all the different cask sizes and we take measurements from them and take like 20 mils from a sherry butt, 10 mils from a hogshead, 7.5 mils from a barrel. We put them all together and we make the blend absolutely in miniature as it would be, because we can't afford to take the chance of mixing everything together and ending up with something that's not right, because you can't take it apart once it's together. So it's a fabulous job. We love setting up all the samples in the sample room, working around, smelling all the casks. And as you probably know already, we take those cask strength samples and we bring them down to 20%, so that makes them easier for us to nose. We can nose many more samples. Adding the water gives a bit of heat to the sample, so helps lift the flavour. So we're able to get much, much deeper into the character of the whisky. It's a lot of work, but something that we absolutely love doing in the blending room, doing these wonderful expressions.
Fantastic. Thank you very much.
Gregor, congratulations on being our first live guest. It took us eight episodes to work out the technology. Just not sure how they put you off now, so you might be on the rest of the night. So thank you, and Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
I have a question, Sandy, for you.
Oh, right, okay.
Can we do this? How many of the samples do you nose when you are in the blending room daily?
Oh, it depends. It depends on the work that's going on. Probably over a week, probably somewhere between sort of 1,500 and 2,000 samples. We're checking the whisky. Not everybody knows that, but we're checking the new distillate straight from the still before it goes into cask to make sure the distilleries are running. This is 21 years in advance. You know, I'm working with stock that's getting laid down for 21 years. In fact, I've touched on this before. I'm not very happy about it because the new distillate I'm testing now, I'll be retired when it comes out. It'll be Kevin Bamforth that will be blending it then.
Oh, my God.
And he'll be saying, what a fabulous job that Sandy has slopped in. He's made my job really easy. Exactly.
That's great.
I've just accidentally removed Gregor entirely from the webinar. So
that
comfortable.
Merry Christmas.
Hopefully, all the best, Gregor. See you later.
Merry Christmas,
bye. Listen, we've got a treat. We've got Chris Brusso, our archivist, online. And nice. Actually, Chris has an original bottle of Royal Salute from 1953. So let me see if we can get Chris. He should rejoin as a panelist. So we'll just wait on and see if that works. There he is. I'll unmute. Hey, Chris, have you got your camera
Hello.
There? Ask to start
yes,
your video.
Okay. How's that?
Hey!
Hello,
hey!
Everyone.
Look at this. He's got on the white gloves.
Yes, this should give you a hint of what's coming up. Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
So what I got past security at Strath Isla, but I want to show you something. I'm going to hold this up to the camera. I hope you can see it okay.
This is precious.
This is the very first bottle in the first run. Anyway, the first run of Royal Salute back in 1953. If you look at it, it had the Royal Coat of Arms. Sam Bromfisch and Seagram got permission to use the Royal Coat of Arms on the very first bottle, the very first run of the green bottles. A lot of people asked why green, and apparently they did surveys. The marketing people had done surveys to show that green represented elegancy and royalty in the UK. A ceramic flagon, foil labels. This was actually went to the US and back. It was imported into the US in 1953. So this is the original bottle. And I'll show you, it came in the bag. And you'll notice nice. On the bag it had ER for Elizabeth Regina.
Brilliant.
Beautiful.
And on the back it had Chivas, and this was the green bag. And the idea for this bag, this was Sam Bronfman was quite obsessed with royalty, and one of the reasons he bought into Chivas Brothers because of the royal warrant. But when the Queen's father visited Canada in 1937, he invented another brand to celebrate the King's arrival. And if there are any Canadians on the call, you'll recognize Crown Royal. And Crown Royal was shaped like a crown, and he developed the bag for Crown Royal, and he carried that on to Royal Salute. Now, the interesting thing is we have this fantastic piece of packaging, a fantastic bottle, 21 years of age in 1953. I mean, it's pretty remarkable. So they had a year, the king had died, they had a year to develop it. He had the mature stocks. He had a master blender, Charles Julian. And he put his team together to put this together. So this is the very first bottle. The second one was actually a brown one. And that ended up with the Robert the Bruce symbol from 1955 onwards. The only thing that probably let him down a bit, this is the box it came in. And I don't think that's faded because every box I've ever seen
looks like
that. Yeah, so I don't think it's faded. So it's the start of the Chivas Regal box. It's in the cross arms and the Royal Salute. So that was out in 1953. most of it went straight over to the U.S. And we have newspaper clippings of when it was arriving in the U.S. So it was quite a remarkable whiskey, and there was nothing else like it on the market. They just launched Chivas 12 about a year or two earlier, but they had the mature stock in Chivas Brothers to come up with Royal Salute.
Don't you think, Chris, it's just amazing that the Royal Salute signature blend now is all the design cues that are there. There's absolutely perfect DNA right back to that first bottling. Wonderful lineage.
Yes, you can see the difference here. You know, it's very recognizable. Went from the Royal Coat of Arms to the Robert the Bruce model for the second batch, and then it's evolved, and this is lovely. The packaging here is just great.
Beautiful. Yeah,
but there's still the same ideas to the cannons. Symbols on
it's
the front.
It's
super. Yeah. Chris, and thanks for digging us out of the archive. You can stay on the call, actually, because I've got no idea how to switch you off. Secondly,
I could turn my camera off, Rob.
Secondly, poor Gregor isn't back on the call. I realised I've removed him entirely, and he's one of our biggest fans, so we need to get a bottle of Royal Salute to Gregor.
I can probably mute my camera if you want.
No, you stay there, Chris. I'm sure you can answer some of these. Question from Gerardo. Question on storing whiskey. Should bottles with corks be kept vertical and not be touched or put on the side from time to time?
I personally would keep it vertical, but don't keep it into a warm environment. I wouldn't store it for long periods of time on its side, because the cork will... There will be a bit of degradation of the cork, and you can sometimes get some slightly musty notes from the cork. So if you're going to be storing it for a long, long time, I would keep it vertical, without a doubt, but not into a warm environment.
Chris, you agree with that? I think.
Yes. Yeah, perfect. Yeah. We noticed in some of the older bottles,
when
we tried to open them, that the actual cork is actually dried out, mm-hmm. And the cork will come off and break on them. So yes, it's right, Sandy.
Brilliant. Well, whilst I go and try and find Gregor, I'm going to ask you just a shout out from Gerardo, who says a big thank you to Laura and all the amazing team at Pernod Ricard, Mexico, Chivas Regal, Mexico, and Sandy. Thank you. And
Gerardo's a massive Chivas fan, massive Royal Salute Chivas fan. He's a dope man.
Robbie, I agree with you entirely. If the cork breaks, you're drinking it too slowly. You get what you deserve.
Fair enough.
Megan, woohoo, Canadians. Just no, and all right, Amma, introduce us to our next whiskey. I'm going to try and message her. I'll don't get him back in. Introduce us to Snow Polo. Tell us all about it, because you were here when it was
let
launched.
Me get my nose in glass. I'm sure you guys can see here the beautiful white flagon. Very bold move for the brand. For us, it's just, again, going back to the Polo collection, I think the Snow Polo edition that was launched officially last year is just absolutely outstanding. It's just incredible. This beautiful whiskey here, of course, I'll let Mr. Hyslop do all the important things in a minute. But the interesting thing about it is that it's the first blended grain whiskey we ever had. So it's a very bold move for us. Also, what is really, really interesting about this whiskey is that we're paying tribute again to the Polo that is played in San Moritz, which is iconic snow resort in Switzerland, in the top of the Alps. And for those who doesn't know, San Moritz has sun 312 days a year, and this beautiful whiskey here has an ABV of 46.5%, which represents the latitude coordinates of San Moritz, which I think is just absolutely incredible. This linking back and everything about it, I can see in your camera, Alex, the packaging, which is a beautiful illustration as well. I love this vintage design, which is pretty, pretty beautiful. So that's all about Snow Polo, and of course, I think we should taste.
Yes,
that's my humble opinion. Let's do what matters.
Chris, when I put you on hold, could you still see us?
No, I disappeared for a while. But
could you hear us? No.
No.
Oh well,
I'll stop my camera.
No. You stay where you are, Chris. You're more than
welcome. You're fine. You're more than welcome. Yeah.
More than welcome.
I gotta go top up.
Trace Gregor Dykeman. This is calling Gregor Dykeman. We've lost. So take us through it, Sandy. Take us through this whiskey.
Amma's touched on the 46%. 46% just really brings up that grain intensity. It's got an amazing nose. It's peaches, but not just peaches. It's peaches and syrup. It's that you were talking earlier about the Royal Salute having that wonderful sweet character that coats the mouth. This is really indulgent. Lovely sweet peach flavours. It's a little bit of raspberries in there as well. It's a bit of sort of citrusy. But the big one for me is vanilla. Those American oak casks, it's bringing vanilla through in abundance. And it almost has a bit of ice cream to the nose. It's that wonderful, sweet, creamy vanilla ice cream. It is wonderful. And the taste. Man alive, the taste's good. It's got that lovely, sweet runny honey. Really beautiful. Coats the mouth again. It's got that... Got a little bit of that, same as the signature blend. It's got that orange marmalade in there, definitely with that little bit of ginger, a little bit of sort of toasted hazelnuts, and a little bit of cinnamon in there. But the finish, whereas the signature blend is that slightly smoky finish, this is just velvety smooth at the finish. It's absolutely beautiful. 21 years, predominantly matured in American oak casks. It is absolutely spot on. We loved creating this in the blending room.
Amazing. And do you know what? I think it's brave. I think it's a bold move going there at 21 grain, you know, introducing a blended grain.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Yeah. Absolutely. But it just shows how good grain whiskey can be. We spent a lot of time selecting some amazing casks to put together for this special release.
So tell me, we know it's Royal, so we know it starts at 21, but Amma, we know we can enjoy this as a cocktail, yeah? Can certainly.
Yes, please, of course. I'm a big fan of this cocktail, sorry. You know, neat, of course, delicious, but cocktail, I think you really introduce for people and the new generation of drinkers into the world of whiskey in a very subtle way. For this one, there is an amazing cocktail called Sub Zero. I'll make sure I put the recipe here for everyone. It's super easy to make at home. You just need three ingredients. You just need, of course, Snow Polo here, Royal Salute. You need Suze, and you need Cassis cream. It's really, really easy. Shake everything, ice on. Happy days. I'll make sure I put the... It's just delicious. Yeah, it's just delicious for the season. I'll make sure I put it here on the chat. The recipe for everyone, I highly recommend. It's delicious to drink.
Ah, beautiful. Beautiful. Yeah,
for
Sandy,
me, for
like
me
it?
Though, for me though, 46%, it has that real strength and depth of character that a couple of blocks of ice in it, give it a good shake. It is just amazing as well. It stands up beautifully to that slow release of the water as the ice melts. It's just absolutely perfect.
Dom's saying a great rusty nail, I would agree. Probably get a wee bit of Loch and Aura in there, perhaps.
Good call.
Remember Loch and Aura? You know, it was a cracker. Someone asked a question. Let me see, Sandy and Chris, you can answer. Have you ever opened any very old bottles? Chris, we've opened a couple of old ones in the archive, haven't we?
Yeah, actually, this one here, Sandy, maybe recall, we sent a sample down about 5 years ago. Yeah. We had one that was completely, all the labels had come off, and the team wanted Sandy to have a look at it. So we actually sampled the one from 1953. Now, I don't know if you recall, Sandy, but...
Yes, I do.
You think of 1953, I mean, I'm assuming you know better than I do, but some of the distilleries that go into Royal Salute today may not have even been built yet. Some of our distilleries,
well,
possible.
Absolutely, but on the flip side of that, we're really lucky because we've had Strathyla in our portfolio and Longmorn in our portfolio for so long. We're lucky we've got that foundation, Chris, that we've been able to build on with other whiskies.
Yeah, and it's great, and it was very—it's very similar to today. Maybe a bit more Madeira sherry in it, but there would have been probably a less selection of malt at 21 years of age in those days and grain. But it was a fabulous whiskey. Did you remember, Sandy? Did you try it?
Yeah, it was. Do you know what? I couldn't believe how close it was to the 21-year-old we were doing. Yeah. You know, obviously, that's our job in the blending team. Quality is really important, but continuity stands shoulder to shoulder with it and keeping it the same, as close as humanly possible year after year. But to be given the opportunity to try the first batch was absolutely brilliant because we could see all the DNA that's there nowadays is still there. They were using a range of casks. You could tell from the nose that they were using barrels, hogsheads, butts. There was not only a selection of different whiskies going in, they were using a range of casks to add to the complexity of the blend.
Yeah, that's great.
Well, listen, I'm going to give you some quick fire questions, okay, as we're drawing to a close. So let me see. Sandy, have you ever encountered a whiskey that's had cork degradation in a bottle from Michael? Does it taste like corked wine?
Yes, it does, absolutely. In fact, you need to make sure that the quality of your corks is really good. We spend a lot of time, our packaging development team spend a lot of time making sure our corks are right. Whiskey, particularly Royal Salute Snow Polo, 46%, that's much stronger than wine. So if there's any hassle with the cork or any slight flaws with the cork, the whiskey will draw that flavour out. People think whiskey is really strong and robust in flavour, but it's very easily bruised. And to answer your question directly, yes, if the cork is not up to quality, you will get musty notes in the whiskey.
And Amma, David's asking, there's a Royal Rose cocktail. Yes.
I'm sure he is.
Okay, right.
I'm sure he will make this question today. So, first of all, David, we miss you. Great to have you here tonight. And the Royal Rose is made with unicorn tears, as he loved to say back in the days. I'm joking. It's made with this incredible rose essence that is the same one that Chanel used for their perfumes. But it's edible, of course, and it literally is more costly than gold, that particular essence. It comes from the region in France called Casse, where in Provence, where they make all the beautiful herbs and petals, etc., for perfumes. And there is a section of that we were sharing the same field with Chanel. So that's why it's so special and so unique.
Yeah. Yeah, mate.
But quite appropriate for Royal Salute, Amma.
I can't
the level
the
that it deserves to be.
Grant is asking Sandy, what's the difference between blending a malt and a grain whiskey at the age of 21 and above? Are there characteristics that stand out?
I think
would you consider a non-chill filtered blend from two questions in one here? From
well, the Royal Salute Snow Polo is non-chill filtered. We didn't chill filter the Snow Polo edition. The same things as a signature blend. You need to watch the influence of the cask, particularly, even more importantly, with the Snow Polo, because the Snow Polo, the grain is a more delicate flavour, and we desperately wanted that sweet peach vanilla, that ice cream flavour coming through in the whiskey. We wanted that bit of raspberry too, and it was really important. Cask selection was massively important with this whiskey.
Yeah, and I suppose one question that I've just looked at there is that if you were blending a blended grain alone, on its own, what are the challenges compared to just blending Royal Salute in its own? I think that's a direct question, yeah?
Yeah, I apply exactly the same quality principles to both. And when we're blending some of the older Royal Salute expressions, like the 38 years old, the 32 years old, the 29-year-old that we did for where they finished in PX casks, we actually, when we were composing it, we put the malt and grains, we did them separately, then introduced the two together. Mm-hmm. So we didn't blend it as a blend. We blended it as individual components, then introduced the two together later.
And then Carrie's asking this million-dollar question. Do blends develop over time, like wine kept in storage in good conditions, or do they not change much at all? Should we be buying these limited editions to save for later?
The great thing about Scotch whisky is once it's in the bottle, it holds its flavour for decades. There is no issues with buying a bottle of whisky and keeping it for a special occasion or a special birthday in years to come. It holds its flavour perfectly. It doesn't mature in the bottle, but that's perfect, because you know the flavour that you're expecting, the flavour that you want to have when you have that special occasion. So absolutely no change of flavour, no falling over of flavour, it becoming flat. It stays really well for a long, long time.
Brilliant. Well, that draws to a close the questions and, of course, our experiment with allowing the audience to ask a question, which we now know, if you ask a question, you'll get chucked.
You're done. Goodbye.
And
I've just discovered you're not allowed to join, so we will get a bottle of Royal Salute to Gregor. I'm going to ask you all a roundup question. Chris, you've been on Scotch Watch. You've been a fan of it for a long while. You're doing a great job in the archive, and thank you for bringing the Royal Salute to us tonight. How are you looking forward to the year ahead? And
well, we obviously, I hope when we can get back into the archive, hopefully, hope things start to clear up, that we can all get together more often. I think, you know, the last year, we're so isolated, even though we're working great as a team online. I think I'm really looking forward to getting back to the archive and meeting people one-on-one, face-to-face, have that daily discussion about what we do and the jobs that we love so much. So I think I'm looking forward to getting back to the archive, in the archive, and getting busy, having people come to the archive and just show them the great heritage that we have. So I'm looking forward to meeting people next year.
Great. And thanks for being part of Scotch Watch, Chris. It's been a pleasure having you on board. And Amma, what an insight you've given us tonight. It's been absolutely incredible. You've been a great guest, you know, telling us about the luxury universe, your day-to-day, and you can feel your passion for Royal Salute just coming through. How has this year been for you, and what are you looking forward to in the year ahead? And also, Amma, thank you for joining us.
First of all, thank you guys. It's such an honor being here with you all and everyone tonight. And I think to me, I really hope 2021 is a better year. It's a year I can get to see people and travel again and take Royal Salute with me across the world. I really hope to see many of you in person in 2021 and also be able to welcome you guys in our new space in Istrofila. So watch this space. Royal Salute is going to have its very own and first brand space where you can come and visit and experience the kingdom of Royal Salute in a very unique way. So this beautiful 1953 green bottle will be displayed there.
Yes. Yep.
So if you guys are lucky enough to wear the white gloves, you will be able to see it in person. So I really hope next year we are physically getting together. And again, thank you so much, guys. It's been a pleasure.
Oh, thank you, Amma. It's been a pleasure hosting you tonight. And you know, Sandy, listen, Scotch Watch was your idea. It's been an incredible year. I think it's brought people together all over the world at a difficult time. I'm looking forward to the year ahead. This is the last one of the year, unless we get that New Year slot that has been vacated by Only an Excuse program that's been dropped. It's absolutely terrible. Sandy, how's it been? A few final words from you.
It's been a difficult year, Alex. I've been really lucky. I've got an amazing blending team that have been working with me on site every single day, making sure that we can keep the blends on spot on flavour, spot on in character. I'm missing the rest of my team, Alex. You know, my planning team, my inventory team, the VI team. I'm missing seeing all them. They're all still working. They're working from home, but I'm looking forward to us all getting back together as one big gang again. You know, it means a lot for us to all get back and get back to some normality. I'm looking forward to travelling with Amma. Goodness me.
haven't had
an adventure for ages. I'm really looking forward to that. Alex, I've had an absolute hoot in Scotch Watch with you. It's way surpassed any expectations I've had. I've had an absolute riot doing it. It's been an absolute pleasure doing it with you this year. It's been really, really good. Thoroughly enjoyed it.
Great. Well, you know, I think, you know, it's interesting you say everyone said what they're missing is people, and I think that's what it's about, us getting together. Conviviality is at the heart of what we do, and we'll do a lot as the new year. We are unique. Well, everyone, thank you. Thank you for joining us tonight. I hope you've enjoyed it. We can only wish you all the very best for Christmas and a prosperous new year in 2021. Thank you for putting swanky in there, Emma. I like that. Looking swanky.
Loving
tonight.
Your work.
Remember, you can follow us all on Instagram, and you can follow Royal Salute on Instagram too. Watch this space for a new, bigger, better Scotch Watch in the new year. We will be coming live again, and hopefully live, not just online. So thank you for joining Scotch Watch. Thank you for joining Royal Salute. We have been uncovering whisky this festive season, one dram and one story at a time. Merry Christmas. Blanger.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Good night.